Ramadan Online. Stay connected to the East London Mosque.
East London Mosque and London Muslim Centre would love to say thank you to the following businesses and charities for sponsoring our Ramadan Online 2021 programme: Islamic Relief, Muntada Aid, Global Relief Trust, Penny Appeal, Muslim Aid, Human Relief Foundation, Muslim Burial Fund, Rani Taylor Solicitors, City Realtor, AWMA Architecture.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. As-salatu was-salamu ala rasulil karim wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh to all the viewers who have joined us on this wonderful program, alhamdulillah. We are very pleased to bring the Ramadan online program to you from East London Masjid and its complex. And alhamdulillah, it gives us great honor to share with you various programs, one of which will be the women's show, inshallah. And as part of this women's show, I have the great pleasure and honor of introducing our speaker for today, inshallah. Syaikha Haifaa Younis, alhamdulillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you doing? Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. I forgot a very important title of yours, Dr. Syaikha Haifaa Younis, alhamdulillah. So I'm going to give a brief introduction to you, although you don't need an introduction, alhamdulillah. You are very popular here with us in the UK. However, it gives me great honor to introduce this short bio to give a short insight into some of the great work that you have accomplished and you go on to do in your day-to-day life. So Dr. Haifaa Younis is an American board-certified obstetrician and gynecologist with roots from Iraq, mashallah. Her pursuit of Islamic knowledge initiated when she began to study with various Islamic scholars from across the United States, while she simultaneously attended individual courses and lectures on subjects including aqidah, fiqh, usul fiqh, hadith, and tazkiyah, purification of the soul. From the United States, she moved to Saudi Arabia, where she graduated from the Mecca Institute of Islamic Studies, Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, and Al-Huda Quran Memorization School, which is also in Jeddah, in Saudi Arabia. She completed the memorization of the Quran. She is also the founder and chairman of Jannah Institute. And alhamdulillah, I know so many people, alhamdulillah, who have benefited from this wonderful institute and currently teaches seminars on the thematic commentary of various chapters of the Holy Quran. She offers retreats on key topics that inspire hearts, combining the inner essence of Islam with an outward expression of practice. Dr. Haifaa is passionate about spreading the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and igniting love of Islam and the Quran through her teachings, alhamdulillah. It's an absolute honor to have you with us, Syaikha Dr. Younis. What I'd like to invite you to do today for us, and many of us are waiting eagerly for this, is to share with us how we can train our hearts to be more attached to the Quran, particularly in this month of Ramadan, where we've been through lockdown, not quite sure what our future holds. There's a lot of still uncertainty, but one of the things that are as close to us is the Quran, subhanAllah. So it would be lovely to hear from you, and if you're okay, to share with us for about 30 minutes, and then we will have a few questions and answers, inshallah.
Sure. Jazakum Allah khair. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me better than what people think of me and forgive what he does, what they don't know about me. Ya Rabbi, Ameen. It's a pleasure. It's always a pleasure to be part of, especially East London Mosque and the sisters in the UK. I have a special bond with them. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. You've been a great support for Jannah, and a good number of our students at Jannah Institute are actually from the UK, and even part of our team, administration team, is actually both from London. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I always make this dua to the brothers and sisters, the Muslims in the UK, to know the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you. You are way far ahead of us in the United States. A lot of dedicated people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase them. Ya Rabbi, Ameen. So speaking about the Quran, and I always start by saying, what this abd of Allah, servant of Allah, will talk about the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I think the first step, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open my heart and to open my tongue. اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي يا ربي أمين. And after I send صلاة على الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام. لما صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه تسليما كثيرا. What do we say about the Quran? And I think one of the, again personally, anything in life, let alone the Quran itself, unless you know what you are reading, learning, listening, the reality of what it is, it's going to be very difficult to have your heart, let alone all your life, connected to it. For example, and take food as an example. Unless you love that food, and you will not love that certain amount or certain kind of a food, unless you know what is that food and you have tasted it. Whatever people tells you is not like when you tasted yourself. Once you taste and love, you will be attached. Not you, not the body, the heart. So even when it is not there and people talk about it, your body reaction will be different. And that applies to everything. So how do I get my heart attached to the Quran? And that's the question. And the answer will be, number one, as a dua that I was taught long time ago, Allahumma la sahla illa ma ja'altahu sahla. Ya Allah, there is nothing easy except what you makes it easy. Anything in life, whether it is daily life, dunya, everyday issue, or it is major issue, whether it is a major issue or a minor issue, whether it is of this life, dunya, or more importantly of the akhirah, nothing will happen, let alone be easy, except what Allah wills and makes it easy. That leads me to, my heart will not get attached to the Quran unless I want to. I really want to. We're not going to talk about how yet. Do you really? And that's the question that every one of us have to ask themselves, myself included, if not number one. Do I really love the words of Allah? Do I really look at the Quran as the words of Allah? Not the book, not the holy book. It's the words of Allah. One. Two, do I really want to learn it, to live it, to memorize it, to understand it, really, not talk? Of course, if I'm going to ask anybody, the answer is yes, of course. Please make dua for me. Then my question is going to come, what effort you put for that journey? What sacrifice you put for that journey? Bringing the heart, bringing the Quran to my heart is a journey. Living the Quran or living by the Quran is a journey. And that journey is not easy. That journey needs a lot of hard work and sacrifice. Hard work and sacrifice. So number one, do you really want it? Ramadan is the best time, not only to answer, but to show you. What is your relationship with the Quran in Ramadan in general? That will tell you where is your relationship. And then after Ramadan, where is the Quran in your life? So the first step is, as they say, is a honest question to yourself. Two, where are you now with the Quran? Number one. Number two, do you really want that journey? Do you really want that result? And three, what steps you took. And I'm sure, I have no doubt, that everybody, there's no Muslim, when you ask them, do you want to have a relationship with the Quran, the answer will be no. I doubt it. But how much is it a priority, and how much I put in it? Practically speaking, where do I start? Unless you learn about the Quran, and I'm going to share with you as we go in this 30 minutes, what did Allah said about the Quran, and what is it? You will not have this feeling and desire and longing to learn it. First thing, first, Surah Al-Baqarah, the cow, chapter 2. First two ayat, Alif Lam Mim, and then ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. I'll share with you some of the verses, but we need to move from just reading to reading. I spend time, so I look and I say, and let me translate, ذلك الكتاب, this is the book, or that is the book, and the book here, الكتاب, القرآن, لا ريب فيه, no doubt in it. Okay? Hudan lilmuttaqin. It's a guidance. It's a guide. To whom? To those who have taqwa. Who is saying this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is His words. The Quran is kalamullah. Al-munazzali ala rasuli. Is the words of Allah that is revealed to Rasul alayhi salatu wa salam. Through Sayyidina Jibreel, that is an act of worship to read it. That is written between the two sides of the Quran, of the book. That's the definition of the Quran, the words of Allah. So the first question, if I want my heart to start getting attached to it, is when I read, do I read with the intention, with the desire, with the longing, with the resolve, I want to understand, I'm not talking about all of it, just take one ayah, understand, see if I am there yet, if I am not, how can I be there? Hudan lilmuttaqin, why the Quran does not guide me? And Allah said this in the beginning, why? للمتقين, am I a person of taqwa? So, first thing I'm going to say, the Quran should be, and this is what I'm getting, as I am going to Ramadan, as I am entering Ramadan, I'm going to say that the Quran, Allah said, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Ya Allah, help me to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let the Quran be in my life. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Help me, show me, guide me. Guidance. What else Allah said about the Quran? Allah said this in Surah Yunus. Ya ayyuha an-nas, qad ja'atkum maw'izatun min rabbikum wa shifaa'un lima fi as-suduri wa hudan wa rahmatan lil 'alamin. Qul bi fadlillahi wa bi rahmatihi fabidhalika falyafrahu huwa khayrun mimma yajma'un. What is Allah saying? Ya ayyuha an-nas, people, all people, everybody, Muslims and non-Muslims, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ, has been revealed to you, had came to you, مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ, from your Lord. What is it? يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ, admonition from your Lord. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ وَهُدًى. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Guidance, admonition, cure and mercy للمؤمنين, to the believers. That's what the Quran is. When I hold the Quran in my hand and open it in Ramadan, outside Ramadan, look at it. May Allah forgive us, but it is a parable so we can understand. You know, when you take a tablet any kind of a tablet. And when you swallow the tablet, you know that this tablet, inshallah, by Allah's grace, will help you, will cure you. You know, because it's a medicine. Do I look at the Quran this way? That's what Allah says. Maw'idah, admonition. Do I look at the Quran when I open it? That there is some coming to me and says, oh you person, this is what it is. It's gonna guide you. Maw'idah. Hudan, guidance. Shifa, cure. Rahmah, loving mercy. Lil mu'mineen, to the believers. And then Allah says, قُلْ, tell them, Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, tell them, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ, by the grace of Allah, and the grace here is a Quran. وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ, and most of the scholars tells you rahmah here is the sunnah, is the Rasul عليه الصلاة والسلام. فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُ, let them rejoice and be happy and enjoy that. خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ, way better to them than what they are collecting. The fact you and me were given the Quran free. What struggle. And I always say this when we meet and we will interact with the reverts, the converts. What struggle they go through. And we born as Muslims and was given to us. And people want us to read it. People encourage us to read it. People want us to understand it. So guidance to those who have taqwa, guidance, cure, rahmah, mercy, loving mercy, lil mu'mineen. It's something I should rejoice in it. So the first thing that I need to change my mindset when I pick up the Quran is not it's the Quran and let's just read it. And sitting and just read it's Ramadan and I have no idea what I'm reading, it's just reading. Yes, when I pick it up, number one, when I open it, I tell myself, this is the words of my Lord. هذا كلام ربي. This is the words of Allah. This is not the word of a human being. This is not the word of the most famous whatever prize winner. This is the words of the Creator. خالقي وربي, my Lord. Look, when you feel this way, even when you touch the Quran will be different. Keep reminding yourself. Not all the time will be able to remember, but remind yourself. This is the words of my Lord. One. Two. It is talking to me. It's not a story, just a story. It's talking to me. It's telling me something. When it says, for example, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say to us in Surah Al-Baqarah, the cow, oh people, children of Israel, remember the blessings of Allah upon you. I as a Muslim, I as a person who's reading the Quran, I need to read this and says, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ, that's to them, but that's to me. اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ, remember the blessings of Allah upon you. The blessings of Allah upon you, where do we start? So when I read it, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking to me, addressing me, as if you are talking to someone, then I have to train myself and tell myself that when I read it, when I close it, I'm guided more. Huda, one ayah, one verse, if I read it well, ask Allah to teach me, to show me I am a better human being. Cure of everything. I don't feel well, I'm feeling down, I don't think I am in the right direction. Just open it. Open it with the intention that this is going to guide me because Allah said so. And the most important thing when related to the Quran is what Allah said also about the Quran. And He said it twice. He said it in Surah An-Nisa and He said it in Surah Muhammad. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Allah said this in Surah Muhammad. why don't they understand the Quran? And actually it's not to understand. Why don't they comprehend? Why don't they reflect? Tadabbur is you understand, you reflect, you practice. Why don't they do that? Allah is saying this. أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا, or there is locks on their hearts. What should I say? When I open the Quran, I am going to say to myself, Ya Allah, open the locks of my heart. Open the locks of my heart. And Allah said it in Surah An-Nisa. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ? Same question. Don't they understand and reflect on the Quran? وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِي غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. And if it was from other than Allah, they would have seen in it so many controversies or contradictions. Here you are, your heart, my heart, attached to the Quran. When I change my heart in the way I look at the Quran, what is it? Who is it from? The word of whom? And what did Allah, why did Allah send it? For what? Is it guidance? Is it directing me? Is it something that I refer to it anytime I want to make a decision? I want to do something or not do something? So what is the relationship of the Quran now I have? Another practical point. And this advice was always given to us in the school of memorization, subhanAllah. The Quran will give you as much as you give the Quran, subhanAllah. You give the Quran a lot of your time, see what will happen to you from understanding, learning, memorizing, reflecting. You give the Quran less, you will get less. And the second beautiful advice, again, we were given as students of memorization, don't give the Quran your leftover time. Don't give the Quran your leftover time. I'm gonna do 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and everything, including social media, including cooking, including cleaning, everything. Not necessarily in a priority. And then when I am done, when I have a little bit of time, I'm gonna go and read the Quran. That's leftover time. Versus, it should be my prime time. When I am full of my energy, I give it to my Quran. The more you give the Quran, the more the Quran will give you. And don't give it your leftover. When you open it up, say to yourself, that's the words of my Lord. That's the word of the one I'm gonna meet one-to-one in person. That's the words of the one who created me, who gave me everything, who facilitated everything for me. سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. He facilitated everything in this earth for you and me. This is all from him, and this is his words. I need to read it, give it my time, my focus, reflect, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide me. And remind myself repeatedly that reading the Quran is an act of worship. Just like I said Allahu Akbar and I'm praying, reading the Quran is an act of worship. Understanding the Quran is an act of worship. Learning how to read the Quran, act of worship. Learning to understand the words, learning Arabic, act of worship. Let alone practicing the Quran is an act of worship. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he, al-qawi, al-aziz, al-qadir, al-qadir, munazzil al-kitab, he is the one who revealed the Quran to ij'al al-Quran rabi'a qulubina. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. And this is a dua of Rasul alayhi salatu wa salam. Allahumma inni amatuk, bintu abdik, bintu amatik, maadin fiya hukmuk, adlun fiya qada'uk. Ya Allah, I am your slave servant. I am your she servant, the daughter of a servant of yours and a she servant of yours. Maadun fiya hukmuk, your hukm, your decree is gonna happen. Adlun fiya qada'uk, your decree and what happens to me is always just. أسألك, I ask you, بكل اسم هو لك. I ask you with every name that is yours. أنزلته في كتابك. You revealed it in your book. أو علمته أحد من خلقك. Or you have taught it to anyone, one of your servants. أو استأثرت به عندك في علم الغيب عندك. Or you kept it in the knowledge of the unseen with you. What is the dua? اجعل القرآن ربيع قلبي ربيع قلوبنا يا الله. Make the Quran the spring of our hearts. وجلاء همومنا and the removal and the cleaner of our worries. وذهاب أحزاننا and the removal of our sadness. يا ربي آمين. Unless يا ربي آمين يا ربي آمين. Unless I look at the Quran in this way. Guidance, admonition, cure, mercy, loving from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when I reach to that state, then the Quran will penetrate my heart, will be part of my life, will be the breath I breathe. And I see myself changed again and again and again and again with it. Ya Rabbi Ameen. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the Quran Rabi'a Qulubina, the spring of our hearts. Jazakumullah khair. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who live to see Ramadan, to live all Ramadan, to give Ramadan its due right. It's Shahrul Quran, Shahrul Rahmah. It's the month of the Quran, it's the month of fasting, it's the month of mercy. Ya Rabbi Ameen. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه تسليما كثيرا.
Syaikha, thank you so much for your wonderful reminder and many reminders in how we can connect better to the Quran inshallah, and particularly in the month of Ramadan. As you were talking, I was making a lot of notes, and some of the key things that struck me as you were speaking, just on a personal level, is really the idea of intention and making dua for Allah to open our hearts and to want to be connected. It's not something yes. that's going to happen the other way. Maybe we will be blessed with that, but the intention and the want and the desire has to come from us as individuals and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our hearts and to make it soft and supple to be able to receive
yes.
The beautiful words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they are His words. The other thing I really liked that you said, which is a good reminder for us, is how honest we are with ourselves. So really to analyze where are we and where is the Quran in our lives in order to analyze and to reflect how important it is. And I love the two nasiha you mentioned, that you can only get as much as you give. So
yes,
being able to give its due right, you will get that back, inshallah. And we know that
yes.
when we give, we may get more back, inshallah.
Yes.
But that sincerity to be there. And the other nasiha, to not give it leftover time. And I think that's really, really interesting, because I find that, you know, being a mother, a wife, somebody who's working, we always think we'll fit the Quran in, but actually we need to uh-huh. fit our lives around the Quran and the Salah in order
yes.
For us to benefit and maximize on the four things that you mentioned, which is guidance,
yes.
admonition,
yes.
Healing, and most importantly, mercy and love. I think that's
yes.
that's really, really important, and it's for believers. So again, it's those who will benefit from that will be those who enter Ramadan and the journey of understanding the Quran and connecting to it through taqwa. So that's some few things amongst many that you've mentioned, subhanAllah. So a couple of questions came to mind for me as you were speaking,
mm-hmm.
that I know, as I mentioned, that particularly women, this is a women's show, some young women, so university, college and school-going young people may say that sometimes there are times in their life that their exams and their studies take priority. and they become very busy with deadlines and you know, schoolwork. So in those times, how can we encourage ourselves if we are these young people, and if we are parents to these young people, how do we encourage them to appreciate or know that there will be barakah in that part of their life if they focus and give their prime time to the Quran? How do you advise us to do that?
Yeah, very good question. This is how I look at it, talking to myself. We're all busy, subhanAllah, and there's always things to do.
Yeah.
In any stage of your life, there is always things to do, and you can be as much busy as you want to be. So the people are very busy with studies and with projects and deadlines. Don't they have some time to look at their social media, text their friends? The answer is yes. Don't they have time to eat? Yes. Don't they have time to sleep? Yes. Why there is no time for the Quran? It's because I don't look at the Quran. And I'll go back to the first thing I mentioned in the talk, is how I look at the Quran. I don't look at the Quran as my life. Haya, resuscitation, is like food. It's like my drink. It's like my friends. And may Allah forgive me. How can I even compare? But I'm just for the audience to understand that part. Time is always there, if I make it. And we say this to our children. If you want to make something, you will make time for it. If it is important for you, you will make time for it. Yes, I'm not going to spend 5 hours reviewing or memorizing or understanding the Quran, and I'm not going to be studying it tomorrow, I have an exam, because that's not pleasing to Allah. But that doesn't mean either or nor. Either or either. No. Together. If I make the Quran, and that's young and old, by the way, if I'm a mother and I'm so busy cooking, preparing food, or doing everything, and then I give the leftover of the Quran, of my time to the Quran, my children will do it, but they're not going to spend their time because of for the food and the cooking. They will do it for something else.
Yeah.
I need, as a parent, to be the role model, that my children will notice, not by talk, by action. Uh-oh, that's after Fajr, my mom is reading her Quran. Oh, this is the 10 minutes after Maghrib, my mom is reading her Quran. Then they know that there is a dedicated time for the Quran. They will follow. And the balance will be, yes, if I'm tomorrow have an exam, yes, I'm not gonna spend 5 hours. But what about when it is summer? What about it's in the weekend? I have time, and I say this to myself before everybody. I have time for everything else. Then when it comes to the Quran, I don't have time. Where is the problem? It's not in the time. It's not in the Quran. It's not in the other things. It's in me and my priorities. If I had the Quran as number one priority in my life, that I look at it as it is my success in this life and the hereafter, I'll make time for it. No doubt. And Allah will make it easy.
Inshallah, inshallah. Which brings me to the point you mentioned, that it's about the mindset, but also about the heart set, how we keep our mind and heart with the intention and the sort of the focus of how we benefit from the Quran and where it is in our life. The second and the last question I really wanted to ask you is, it's somebody who struggles connecting to the Quran. Sometimes, you know, I hear people say that as soon as they sit with the Quran, everything else, it's a bit like the prayer. You know, they think of all the other things that need to be done. Is there
Absolutely.
Some prerequisites or preparation we can do before we sit with the Quran that can keep our hearts at rest and minds at rest
okay.
while we recite and connect with the Quran?
Very good question. Practical reality. I'm going to answer you also from the Quran. Allah knows, Allah created us. The only act of worship that Allah mentioned clearly in the Quran twice, to seek refuge in Allah from shaitan, is when we read the Quran. فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. When you are about to read the Quran, seek refuge from shaitan الرَّجِيمِ. إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ لَهُ سُلْطَانٌ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. It's in Surah An-Nahl. Allah knows that the moment I'm gonna pick up the Quran, shaitan is here. And he is gonna remind me and you of everything important and non-important. Oh, I have to go and get something. Oh, let me do this. Oh, let me just look and see what's on my, on and on and on. Shaitan works on my nafs, both they work, I'm weak, and I will surrender. Keep asking Allah refuge in Allah from a shaitan rajim. That's number one. As you start, as you are reading, as you are understanding. الاستعانة بالله إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. Seek help from Allah. What is الفاتحة teaches you and me? إياك نعبد, you only we worship, وإياك نستعين, and you only we rely on and ask for help. Ask Allah in your own language. Ya Allah, make me focus. Ya Allah, please let me sit for 5 minutes. Keep asking this. Allah knows you're sincere. يعلم السر وأخفى. He knows the secret and what is not even a secret yet. And He will help you. So practical answer, number one, keep asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to refuge, to help you, to protect you, to shield you from Allah. Two, remove the distractions. Shut off your phone. Don't bring it close to you when you are reading the Quran. If you have to, like for example, I'm worried the hospital will call me, turn off the internet. Keep it as a phone, as it used to be before. Don't read the Quran and everybody is around you talking and you're not going to be able to focus. 5-10 minutes in your musalla, wherever you pray normally in your home. Close the door and remove the distractions. And keep asking Allah before you read, as you are reading, after. In part of your dua that you make, supplication that you make for your children, for your life, for everything, Ya Allah, as the dua I shared with you, make the Quran the spring of my heart, meaning facilitated. I'm less distracted. I love it. I want to learn it. Wallahi ladhi allahu, He will never let you down. Subhanallah.
Subhanallah. May Allah accept it from us all, inshallah. And for all Ya those Rabbi who are trying in Ramadan to connect to the Quran. It leaves me, it's sad that the program's come to an end, and we hope to see you in the future, inshallah, in other programs. So, Jazakumullah khair once again for giving us your valuable time. We know how busy you are and the schedule that you have, alhamdulillah. We have benefited much. Well, I have, alhamdulillah, and I'm sure the viewers have benefited as much. So with that, I wanted to conclude our program today. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ramadan Online. Stay connected to the East London Mosque.
Assalamu alaikum. The East London Mosque and London Muslim Centre has been providing vital services for our community for many, many decades, be that religious, social welfare or educational needs. During the COVID-19 lockdown, the masjid was shut for almost 5 months. And subhanAllah, what a testing period this was for many of us.
During the lockdown, we managed to provide many vital services for the community. For example, online Islamic talks, advice and counselling by phone, food bank, medicine delivery, and support for burials.
As you know, government restrictions mean that we are currently operating at reduced capacity. This has meant, like many organisations, the mosque's income has significantly reduced. The mosque needs your support now more than ever. Please do consider setting up a regular donation and a standing order. You can do this by visiting our website. Thank you so much. Assalamu alaikum.